Hello, I'm Pastor Tier Hardy, and on behalf of my colleagues and friends, Pastor Ed Walker and Pastor Jeff Goodman, welcome to worship with Mount Olivet. Whether you're tuning in on Sunday morning or Tuesday afternoon, thank you for worshiping with us today. Please take a moment and let us know you're worshiping with us. You can register your attendance, view the order of worship for this service, and let us know of any prayer requests you may have on our website. Just go to the web address or use the QR code on your screen. To use the QR code, point your phone or tablet camera at your screen and follow the link. You can also make your tithes and offerings to the church electronically. Our giving is just one way we participate in God's mission around the world and here in Arlington. During the Advent season, we are collecting a special offering that will be used to support ministries in Arlington and around the world. One of those recipients is Culpeper Garden. For over 50 years, Culpeper Garden has been providing affordable housing for seniors here in Arlington. Christmas Eve is just a few days away, and we need your help. Christmas Eve at Mount Olivet is a busy night, and to help us prepare the sanctuary and fellowship hall for worship, we are asking you to let us know that you're coming to church. RSVP for any service online right now. Go ahead. I'll wait. Your RSVP will help the worship team as we make our final preparations for the holiest night and busiest night of the church year. Now I invite you to make the space around you a holy space during this worship service. Light a candle or an Advent wreath as you're able. Find your favorite spot on the couch or move the dog from your chair. Top off your peppermint mocha and find a snack for the kid. It's time for us to worship, proclaiming the time is near of the crowning of the year. Dr. Brian, hit it.
John came out of the wilderness to preach repentance. He preaches to us still. Make straight the paths we now walk and prepare the way for God's reign of justice and love. Covenant God, you send us messengers to cleanse and refine us for your coming. Help us endure the mirror of your prophet's message that we may see you when you suddenly appear among us through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our first scripture reading is from Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire, and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi, and refine them like gold and silver, until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, as in the days of old, and as in former years. Our second scripture reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Licinius ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Hi, boys and girls. So we're getting close, aren't we? I'm getting excited about Christmas. So this morning in the scripture, we heard about a man named John the Baptist. John the Baptist came to tell people to get ready. Get ready, the Savior is coming. So I had something today maybe would help us get ready. I brought this, do you know what this is? Yeah, a smoke alarm. Maybe you have one in your house. So if there was a fire at night when you were asleep, the alarm would go off, it would wake us up, would tell us we need to get out of the house really quickly and we could get to safety. Let's see if we can get this thing to beep. Wow, that was a really loud beep. That would wake us up, wouldn't it? It would wake us up and warn us that we better get ready and go to safety. You know, John the Baptist was a bit like this smoke detector. A long time ago, many of the people living in Israel were not thinking about God and not living the way they were supposed to be living. So John the Baptist sounded the alarm by saying, "Wake up." He used the word repent, which means turn around, kind of change the way you're living. Get ready for the Savior. So I think it's really important during this season that we remember to get ready for Jesus. There's a lot to do and we think about a lot of other things, but it's really not about us, is it? I mean, I have a hard time. I want to think about what presents I'm going to get, what I'm going to do for fun. When's my vacation? But really, we're supposed to be thinking about Jesus and what that means and kind of how we live our lives. What do we do? How do we help people? How are we kind? That's the way we get ready for the Savior. And you know, without Jesus, there is no Christmas. So that helps us remember Christmas is really about Jesus.
That was lovely to be able to hear a full choir like that this morning. Thank you very much. Thank you. Ooh, more and more things that we can see that are part of our traditions and things we've done in the past. It's a great feeling. Good morning to you all. My name is Sarah Calvert. I am your district superintendent. I have been for a few years, recently I've picked up a whole nother district. So have mercy on me and say a prayer for me when you get a chance. But I've come here today because we have a very important thing to do. And I hope you'll play along with me because it's no fun if you don't. I want to do some Advent bingo here for a minute. I want to see how you're doing in getting back to all of these traditions that we have. So your free square in your bingo card is that you know, right, because your people in church or your people who are watching, and I hope you've heard at some point, we are in the Advent season. We're not at Christmas yet, right? Christmas comes on December 25th. So right now we're in that beautiful season of preparing for it. So here's your bingo, and you can raise your hands if this applies to you. You have already done at least 3 dozen cookies. Who's my cookie baker? Has anybody got to that yet? Nobody. Anybody back here? Oh my goodness, you guys are falling behind. We got work to do. All right, you've watched 3 Christmas movies. Anybody? Oh, there we got some Hallmark people, I'll bet. Okay. All right, you've strung at least 3 strings of light, but the ones on the tree that are already there don't count. So 3 strings of light, anybody? Oh, there we go, the lights went up. There we go, we got some lights out there, excellent. You've sent at least 3 Christmas cards yet. Anybody got their Christmas cards? Ooh, we got some good people, got some back here, excellent. Well, those are great things to have accomplished so far, but those are all Christmas things. So maybe what would be Advent bingo? Let me think for a minute. Fear and trembling. Okay, oh good. Yeah, we've had a lot of that. Purification with fire. Anybody got that down? No, haven't seen any of that. All right. Beating and stamping us until we're clean. Anybody got that beating and stamping? Little extra lye soap in there maybe? No, nobody? All right. Oh, and a heaping plate of repentance, turning and going a different way. I think this is a Christmas cookie recipe, something about locusts and honey in the wilderness. Maybe baking those, yeah. Locusts and honey in the wilderness, that sounds good. Maybe not, I'm vegan. I don't think locusts are vegan, and honey probably isn't either. Oh, and the entire world turned upside down. Permanently and forever, you know? Okay. We've seen some of that. Kind of like that movie Inception, which is not a Christmas movie. Neither's Die Hard, but we'll talk about that later. I know the Advent bingo doesn't sound like as much fun as the Christmas bingo, does it? I mean, who wants this? I kind of want Norman Rockwell and Martha Stewart kind of Christmas and Advent. But instead, I get Malachi and John the Baptist. Not a crazy couple, I'm just saying. But these are 2 messengers that God sent us, one from the Hebrew Bible, Malachi. We don't talk about Malachi too often. He is the last prophet. Let's see, I wandered into the youth today, and they were looking at the first prophet, Samuel, but Malachi is the last prophet of the Hebrew text. And he was a messenger from God. His name actually means messenger. That may not have been his name. It may have been his title. And it pretty much wasn't a Christmas lights and cookies sort of prophecy he was giving us. He was saying that there will be a messenger coming who will prepare you for the refiner's fire. A refiner, metal workers, use fire to purify metals till they are pure. If you are purifying a metal, one of the ways you can tell that you've got all the impurities out is if you look at it and see your reflection. Malachi is saying that when the king comes, when the Messiah comes, we will be so purified and made holy that we will see God's image in us. We are the refined. That's a beautiful picture. Fuller's soap, he says, will be clean with that lovely lye soap that was used for many centuries. Cleaning the white garments was a tradition that Malachi is referencing. Cleaning up like you would if, say, the king was coming or Jesus for dinner. These are good things, but these are not easy things. These are things that are challenging to us, things that challenge who we are. We know we are beloved and made in the image of Christ, but Malachi is suggesting there are things we can do. There is work to be done on ourselves. After Malachi, there is a 400-year wait for this messenger. And Luke picks up the story with the messenger out in the wilderness. John the Baptist has come to prepare the way. John the Baptist has come. He's found in the wilderness. Now, his people are all priests from the temple, but he's not in the temple. He's not in church. He is out in the wilderness eating locusts and honey. We talked about that cookie recipe, probably not the best. But he picks up that message from Malachi, and he is the messenger to say that there is someone coming that you need to know about. This is a different than anything that's ever happened before. Yes, this may be the Messiah you've waited for. Yes, this may be the king you desire. But this is God incarnate that is coming. And that is what John the Baptist wants us to know. And he picks up another prophet. He picks up Isaiah. He picks up the story that Isaiah said about the entire world is about to be transformed. Did you hear the physicalness of that transformation? Roads that are crooked are now straight. Mountains are laid flat. The entire physical world is going to be changed by the coming of this tiny baby, who by this point, when John is preaching, is now a grown adult who is about to start his ministry. The whole world will be made new, so that, we were told, we understand the salvation that is about to come to us, so we can see it. This is the whole point of Jesus coming, isn't it? So that we can see in the flesh, just like you and I have. In the flesh, we can see, John tells us. So would you not clean things up if Jesus were coming over for Christmas dinner? Would you not scrub your clothes and make things anew? Shine up the things that are already good and beloved that you have, but could use a dusting, could use some impurities cleaned out. Shine that silver. We have two messengers of this Advent season, and traditionally, Advent was not the run-up to Christmas. We've made it that way. Advent was a time of quiet, peaceful, as the kids were talking about, reflection. What impurities are in my life that maybe need some purification? What scrubbing could I do for those bits of dirt, sin, struggle in my life? Our struggle to do well, to love well, to do justice, to love mercy, it isn't always perfect. Our shortcomings in the light of this intense new thing, this incarnation, are to become obvious. This is what both Malachi and John the Baptist and even Isaiah are telling us. Our shortcomings, and they are there, are to become obvious in the light of pure love come into this world. And this is an individual work, this season of Advent, but this is also a community work. This is the work of the church, which, as many of us know, has imperfections as well, has struggles, has places where we have fallen short, where we have not loved as well as we could love, where we have not been part of justice, where justice was needed. In this world, 2,000 years later, I wonder what Jesus would say, that we still struggle with things like racism, that we still struggle with those who are in and those who are outside of our communities, where we still struggle to accept, to love perfectly as we have been loved by the incarnation of Jesus Christ in this world. Like Lent before Easter, we need space to prepare. We need to be washed clean, purified, so that God's love can be plainly seen in all that we do. In all that we do. From honking at people on the roads, to loving that hard-to-love member of our family, to working for justice here right now in the middle of this work of this church and this community. So if in our Christmas bingo we may have realized that maybe we do have a bit of a shopping problem, or eating, or alcohol, maybe our relationships are a struggle, or maybe the one that is probably most famous in this area, I am too important and too busy to think about God in this season. That is not what Advent is about. Prayer, fasting, reflection, these are the ways in which we are made new again in the image of God. Because we were made perfectly, and yet, as Wesley tells us, we are continually bent towards sinning. It's restoration and the beauty of God's image in us that is brought out to the fullest in the light of that incarnation. So as you make those 3 dozen Christmas cookies, maybe take some to a neighbor. Oh, not the neighbor that's always nice to you and always good. That neighbor. Come on, you know who I'm talking about. Come on, you know who I'm talking about. That neighbor. A bit of love in a Christmas cookie. And that Christmas movie that your spouse or your friend or your partner wants to watch for the 400th time, love them enough to watch it with them without complaining. Boy, that's a Christmas gift if ever there was one. We have relationships to work on, even our closest. Oh, and those Christmas lights that shine on us to reflect where we are, those Christmas lights can remind us of the work we have yet to do. And those Christmas cards, I think of all those who don't receive Christmas cards in this season. I've done some work with Kairos over the years, the people that are incarcerated. I did a Kairos once over Mother's Day weekend in a women's prison. They did not get cards, but we sent cards. And the tears that flowed from the work that was yet to be done for those mothers. The people that are forgotten, the least, the lost, the people who do not have justice or mercy or kindness from our communities as a rule. This is the work of Advent, to lift up in light of pure love and light where we have work to do. It may not be as fun, but we can still have fun doing it. And it may be painful. Fire and scrubbing, those are painful things. But that does not mean that the work is not good for us, good for our churches, good for the community that we serve, good for the people of God, each of whom has been made perfect in God's image. So let your Advent have some Christmas, and let your Christmas have some Advent in this season. Take the word of the 2 prophets of old, Malachi and John the Baptist. In light of the incredible upside-down world that God gave us by bringing us his Son, love a little bit more, shine a little bit more. Be in community working for justice and peace a little bit more. And this season will mean a whole lot more for you, for your church, for your community. Let us pray. Lord, in this season, help us to lift up those places where, ouch, it hurts. We want to be so busy we forget, but Lord, help us to remember. We want to be so busy that we are excused for less than loving, less than kind, less than justice. But Lord, in you, we know that we can find our work, our hope, and perfect love to clean us up, and love us to what God has next for us. Lord, we thank you for that blessed fire. We thank you for that scrub. We thank you for the goodness you bring out in us so that we more closely reflect you. Thank you for your Son. Thank you for that moment of incarnation when you loved us so much, you wanted us to see our salvation. Thank you, Lord, in this Advent season. Amen.
The holly, and so does the ivy. In the winter winds blow, and so high. And green grows the holly. Gay are the flowers, hedgerows and the plowhands. The day.
In this season of watching and waiting, let us pray for all people and places that yearn for God's presence. Nurturing God, you give us life and care for our every need. Use the church's gifts and ministries for your service, bringing your word to all who see your transforming grace. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Creator God, you proclaim your boundless love for all that you have made. Renew barren lands, polluted waters, and melting ice caps. Make us servants of your creation that brings forth abundant life. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Righteous God, you bring down the mighty and lift up the lowly. Strengthen those who seek justice. Bless the work of community organizers, activists, journalists, and all who call our attention to imbalances of power. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Compassionate God, you proclaim your love and mercy. Show your kindness to teen parents and to those who are pregnant. Comfort any struggling with infertility and those who await test results, are in treatment and hospice care, and others in need. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Gracious God, you fill the hungry with good things. Bless the feeding ministries of this congregation and the community. Guide us to share your bounty with those who hunger or live in poverty. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Faithful God, you stir up the hearts of those who love you. We give you thanks for those who, like Mary, were courageous in their witness. Give us such courage until that day when you fulfill all things. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of new life, you come among us in the places we least expect. Receive these prayers and those in our hearts in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you to my favorite district superintendent in all of United Methodist Church, Reverend Dr. Sarah Calvert, for joining us in worship today. Now, go with the love of God, our Creator, the grace and peace of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and go, being filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. Amen.